Edexcel AS Mathematics, D1 from May 2011. Question 7. And while this looks like a network that I've seen many times in many questions, it's not. This is an activity network. You can see that there are arrows on the arcs, and there are things such as dummy activities, those dashed lines. The wording, before I even read it, I know roughly what it's going to say. It's a project modelled by the activity network. The activities are represented by the arcs. The numbers in brackets are the time in days to complete the activity. Each activity requires one worker. I've never seen a variation on that, but be prepared. Each activity could take two workers. The project is to be completed in the shortest possible time. And as usual, I've got to complete a precedence table, and I've got to complete a diagram of early and late times. Particularly that second part is a very common question. So, let's do the precedence table first. Looking at my graph, I can see that A and B need nothing. They can be done right at the start. The first activity I need to fill in here is C. You can see C comes after A, but because of this dummy line coming up from here, it also needs to come after B. So C is preceded by A and B, and it's that dummy that makes it the B. Next, they want me to fill in what E is preceded by. E is here. That is also preceded by A and by B because of that dummy line. So A and B. The next one I need to fill in is H. H is down here. So you can see H comes directly after C and directly after D. So H is preceded by C and D. Some people say, yeah, but doesn't H come after A as well? But you're just looking at the direct precedence. So C is immediately before H and D is immediately before H. So finally, I've got I, J, K and L to complete. I, E comes immediately before I, and because of the dummy, so does whatever finishes here. Well, that's C, comes immediately before I, and also D comes immediately before I. So there's three there, E, C and D. I think that's probably the easiest one to make a mistake on, because that dummy is coming off the end of C and D. J over here comes immediately after E, and also because of this dummy, C and D. So J is E, C and D. K, you can see, comes immediately after I, H and F. I, H and F. And finally, L down here, that comes immediately after G. And because of the dummy, there's a lot here, it comes immediately after F, H and I. So in total, that was I, H, F and G. And you will write neater than me and fit them all in that box. But that is the precedence table complete. There are 3 marks available for this question. The first mark is for the activities preceded by A and B. The second mark is for the CD and the ECD ones. And finally, a third mark for the IHF and IHFG activities. You will notice that these are all B marks, so you simply need to state the right answer. There really is no working to be shown there. So you need to be careful and make sure you get the right answer. So now I need to fill in the graph with the earliest start times and the latest finishing times. I want to get started as soon as possible, and that is obviously after 0. And remember, it said this was in days, it could be minutes or hours or anything like that. So now I'm going to move forwards, and you don't need to write this in the exam, but I'm writing it for you, and I think you should write it down when you're revising. When you go forwards, you add and take the biggest. What do I mean by that? Well, let's take the first box. What arrows are going into it? We've got here, 0 plus 4, because there's a 0 there, and the activity takes 4 minutes. Or I've got this arrow coming in, and I don't know what to add on yet, so I can't do this box. So let's do this box down here. Here I have 0 plus 7. There are no other arrows going into this box, so 0 plus 7 is 7. Now, I can say 0 plus 4 is 4, or 7 plus, and a dummy activity has a weight of 0. So that would be 7 plus 0. I'm going forwards, I'm adding and taking the biggest. 0 plus 4, or 7 plus 0, the biggest there is the 7. Now we select the next box. I have a box here. The arrows going into it, I'm either going to have the 7 plus 4, or I'm going to have 7 plus 5. 7 plus 5. I'm going forwards, so I take the biggest. 7 plus 5 is clearly bigger, and that has a time of 12. Notice I'm going forwards the whole time, I'm adding, and I'm taking the biggest. So now I've come to this box here. It's either 7 plus 2, or it's 12 plus the dummy activity, which has a weight of 0. 7 plus 2 is 9, 12 plus 0 is 12. Continuing this in a similar vein all the way through, being very careful. A box like this has 3 arrows going into it. 12 plus 3 is 15, 12 plus 4 is 16, or 7 plus 5 is 12. The biggest number I said there was 16. This box here cannot be done yet, because I don't know the weight of this time going into it, so I need to do this box first. It's either 16 plus 0, which is 16, or 7 plus 4, which is 11. I'm going forwards, adding, taking the biggest. Now I can complete the final box. 12 plus 10 is 22, 16 plus 5 is 21, or 16 plus 6 is 22. So, clearly the biggest number I said there was 22. That is complete in terms of the earliest start times. There is a method mark if it is clear you have gone forwards, adding, taking the biggest. An accuracy mark for getting all of those top numbers correct. So how do I get the other two marks? Well, this is the backwards pass. We're doing the opposite. So instead of adding, that's right, we're going to subtract, and instead of taking the biggest, we're going to take the smallest. Now, I think this is a little tricky, because now we've got the arrows going in the opposite direction. For example, if I consider this box here, I have two arrows going into it, because the arrows now go backwards. So, obviously, if I want to finish after 22, that is the latest I can finish. Now, there's just one arrow going into this box here, so I do 22, take away the 6, and I get 16. That's the only possibility. I now have 16 take away the dummy, which is 0, or I have 22 minus 5. Now, because I'm going backwards, I take the smallest. 22 take away 5 is 17. 16 take away 0 is 16. The smallest of that is 16. Can I do this box? Well, not yet, because I don't know that time there. Can I do this box? Yes, the two arrows going into it, I know. So 22 take away 10 is 12, or 16 take away 3 is 13. The smallest is 12. I continue in a similar vein. You may now want to pause the video and complete this yourself. I'm going to do so and I will comment, but obviously I'm running out of room to put my writing on. You won't on your examination, but I don't want to move on the page. I want you to see the completed solution. So next I can obviously go into this box. It's 12 minus 0 is 12, or 16 minus 4 is also 12. So the answer must be 12. 12 minus 2 is 10. 12 minus 4 is 8. Going backwards, I choose the smallest number, which is 8. 12 minus 5 is 7. 16 minus 5 is 11. 16 minus 4 is 12. The smallest number I just said was 12 minus 5, which is 7. And finally, 7 take away 7 is 0, or 8 take away 4 is 4. I obviously need to end with the smallest number, which is 0. Notice that these two numbers are always the same, as are these two numbers. There is again a method mark if it's obvious you're subtracting and taking the smallest solutions, and an accuracy mark for all correct numbers. And that is my completed graph. But there are still two further marks to be gained by writing down the critical activities. To do this, I need to consider which activities must be completed in order. Such activities will pass between doubles. So, for example, I've got 0,0 and 7,7. Now, that doesn't mean that activity B is critical. Is 0 plus the length of the time, which is 7,7? Yes. So, B is critical. But don't assume that all doubles between them are critical. If I take the 16,16 here and the 22,22 here, the activity K, which I've just written over there, has a length of 5. And 16 plus 5 is not 22. So that is not critical. But critical activities must pass between these double points that I have written on my graph. So I just consider each one. Is 7 plus 5 12? Yes, it is. Is 7 plus 5 16? No. Is 7 plus 4 11? Well, it is, which isn't 16, so no. Is 12 plus 0 12? Well, of course it is. Is 12 plus 10 22? Yes, of course it is. Is 12 plus 3 16? No. Is 12 plus 4 16? Yes. And finally, are there any others? Yes, there is here. Between 16 and 16, obviously the dummy is critical. But obviously that's not a task, an activity that needs doing. Finally, is 16 plus 6 22? Yes. Now, one thing to point out with this is there will always be a path of the critical activities. They can't come to a dead end. So you can see that I have a path up there to the end. Or I could go this way. You can have two paths, but you must be able to go from beginning to end along your critical activities. So finally, the answers here are B, D, J, H, and L. Obviously, we don't write down the dummy. There are two marks there. The method mark, it's hard to say precisely how you will get that, but it has to be clear you've considered the difference between tasks. And obviously, the accuracy mark is for getting the activities B, D, J, H, and L. You will get a critical path analysis task. I don't know what part B and C will often ask, but you will have to fill in the earliest and latest start times. So make sure you know how to do this question. So in part D of this question, I've been asked to draw a cascade or Gantt chart. It's a very common question, and out of these four marks, I should be guaranteeing myself at least two of them. The reason for that is that it's always the same. Across the top of your Gantt chart, you have your critical activities. I saw that that was B, you can see running between 0 and 7, so nice rectangle between 0 and 7, and you should use your ruler quite quickly. Then we had D between 7 and 12. This was a dummy activity there, so I'll go this way first. H between 12 and 16. That was also a dummy activity. So between 16 and 22, I had L. But there's this other critical activity here between 12 and 22 of J. And I'll have to just slot that underneath my critical activities. Doing this here, in other words, considering the critical activities, gets you a method mark, and doing it correctly gets you an accuracy marks. So even if you're not quite sure about floats and the rest of this Gantt chart, you should be getting two of those four marks. Now I'm just going to consider the activities in alphabetical order. Let's take A first of all. A can start at zero and takes 4 minutes. So I suggest a new line for each activity. Some will say, well, if you can have space to slot it in, then do so. And while it wouldn't be wrong, I find it easier to do this. So A can start at zero, takes 4 minutes, but doesn't have to finish until eight. So I can go all the way up to eight, and that's called the float. Going in alphabetical order, I've got B. The next activity is C. C can start at seven and takes 4 minutes. So starting at 7, 4 minutes takes me up to 11. But you can see that I don't have to finish until 12. So there's a little bit of float tagged on the end there. D is on my Gantt chart already. E can start at 7 and only takes 2 minutes. So starting at 7, just adding on, I believe it was days, not minutes. The numbers are the same regardless. But E doesn't have to finish until 12, so I've got the float up to 12 again there. A, B, C, D, E, F I'm up to, can start at 7, takes 5 days, so F starts at 7 plus 5 is 11, so there's F, but it doesn't have to finish until 16, so that's quite a lot a float on F. G also starts at 7 and takes 4 days. 4 days there, but doesn't have to finish until 16. So that has a similar float. Now I've just seen I've made a slight mistake. Glad I spotted it. You may have heard it yourself. I said F starts at 7 and takes 5 days, and you can see there I've only drawn it equaling 4. So just showing you the advantage of writing in pencil when you do these kind of graphs, because if you go wrong and you don't notice it, A, you'll lose marks, or B, it's very hard to spot it, very hard to do your corrections. You've only got one answer booklet. You can ask for extra paper, but obviously that won't have all the diagrams on that you need. Carrying on, I've got H up there. I can start at 12 and takes 3 days. So we're moving up here now. I can start at 12 and takes 3 days. That takes it to 15. But it doesn't have to finish until 16. So I've got a little bit of float, not much there. And finally, K is my last activity going through the alphabet. K can start at 16, takes 5 days. So from 16, 5 takes me all the way up to 21, but it doesn't have to finish until 22. So there's a little bit of float there. It was a 4-mark question. Two of those were for the critical activities. Second method mark is for considering activities and their floats, and an accuracy mark if you get them all correct. But you should definitely be getting the 2 marks here for doing the critical activities. That's the same for every Gantt chart. Finally, and this is a very common question, in part E, they have asked me to consider the activities that take place between 7 and time 16. So let me just highlight those on my graph. I'm looking at these activities there, and you'll forgive my not quite straight line. I've got to explain why it's not possible to complete this project with just 3 workers in the minimum time. You see, I can consider several different moments in time. If I just consider around 10 and a half days, activity D is being done, activity C is being done, activity F is being done, and activity G is being done. So at the moment, at 10.5, we're doing, well, D, F, or D, C, F, and G. So what's the point of a Gantt chart? Well, it demonstrates how to use float. You see, I could move F across into its float space, or I could move G across. And that would mean that I don't need all four activities with four workers, I would just need three. Now, when these explain questions, you've got to pretend you're talking, and I often say to a younger brother or sister. So they would just say, well, why can't I do F later? You only need to give one example. If I move F, that would put it at the end here, then you could see that at time 14, I would have H, J, I've now got F because I've moved it, and I. So if I move F, I would be doing H, J, F, and I at 14. So I've given a clear example there of why I need four workers. So it's not possible with just three workers, because the float will allow me to move it, but I'd need four workers at different times. So I just need to say that in some clear sentence. So therefore, need, I'm going to put more than three workers. And that's how I get the three marks. So you're probably wondering where those three marks come from. They're all B marks. Obviously, one is for stating an example where you need more than three. You're going to need to question the fact about the float. So the second mark is going to be for saying, well, I can use the float, but it won't help, because you've given two examples of where you'd need more than three workers, even allowing for the float. Now, that last bit of that question is quite challenging, and I know some of you will be thinking, how do I do it? And forgive me, that's my fault. I obviously haven't explained it clear enough. It is difficult. Do see your teacher, or go on other tutorials where you can see more and more. And the more you do, the more experience you have, the easier you'll find these questions. But what I can say is that completing the activity network is going to get you most of the marks, and the Gantt chart can be learned quite simply. Actually understanding and interpreting it does take practice, and so good luck with that practice. I hope you have time before your examination, but I hope this has helped you a little bit. Follow me on Twitter at MathOrMaths, and check out my Facebook page for regular updates of regular uploads. Good luck with your examinations.